Okay, so if you have succeeded at connecting the three sensors and extending the code so that you can read from all three of them, you should now in your screen have something that looks like this, and your board should look something like what you have on the right hand side as well. Now, as you can see, every time I block the light in one of the sensors, so I can kind of use it as a trumpet. So that's the blue sensor, the one represented in the blue graph. That's my first. That's my second. So that's red. See how the light levels in the others are also affected? That's basically because there is always a little bit of light bouncing off my finger, or I am casting a shadow. They will interact with each other. But of course, the one where it's more noticeable, the change, is the one where I place my finger on top. Now, my light source is on top of the circuit, from more or less from where the camera is coming. So if I turn my circuit just like this, I have now something that can be used like an ocarina or as a trumpet. That's two fingers out, one, but as you can see, I'm casting a shadow. So the signals are the signals can basically give us an understanding of where our fingers are placed. Now, you might be seeing that I'm actually getting different readings from the sensors. So one of them reads like 1500, the other reads like 1300, and the other reads like 1200. That doesn't matter so much. That happens because, well, the make of the sensors is different. They might be from different brands, or they are just, they have some material differences. This is perfectly normal. When we work with these kind of sensors, what we aim to detect is the difference, the percentage of change, rather than the absolute values. There we have something that could potentially give us a, say, three-finger interaction. Or if this was, for example, if we embedded these sensors on the sides of a cube, we could detect which side is up and which side is against the table. We could also, I'll show you an example from a project I did in the past where I built an interactive lamp in a media architecture festival using these very simple and very cheap sensors. So I really love these sensors because they are so versatile and so simple. They are easy to understand. They are perhaps from all the sensors the ones that are the most direct. You can just really play with them. You don't even need to touch them. Just putting my fingers like through just between this source of light and the sensors gives you already some kind of interaction. And notice also how it can in fact read every finger separately. So that's the first falling down, second, third. It gives you a little dip on every finger. So if you can basically cast a shadow on one of these sensors, even if they are several meters away from you, as long as you have some control over the lighting conditions, you can do some pretty cool stuff, even though they are so simple. Well, I hope this serves as a little demo, and hope you can make something cool with this. Oh, there's one thing I forget. Wait, let me show you. Of course, right now these sensors are, of course, stuck in that board. Let me place the mic there. Okay. So they are stuck in this board, so you cannot really do much in terms of placement other than just play around with them like this. But here's another possibility. You can also attach the autofocus plays on my side this time. So you can also attach one of these sensors and solder. You'll probably, unless you have soldering equipment at home, you'll probably have to come to the lab and do this. But you can also extend the legs of the light sensor and put two pinned cables at the end. So you can, I will replace now live while we do this, one of these by the extended one. Hopefully you are also seeing the graph on the right hand side. And and now this I have this sensor here. This one now can be embedded somewhere else. So it's just a little easier to work. And this now is the green one. So I'll do that again. So that's the green one, you see. But of course, now I can point it to the light, and it's a bit more versatile than having them stuck on the solderless breadboard. So that's another possibility of how you could play around a bit more with this circuit. I'll put this one back, and well, I think that's the demo that I wanted to do with you today on this video. So I'll stop it here. Okay, thanks for watching.